All right, my friends, Brian here with VetteSource this afternoon. Hoping you guys are having a great day, where we're going to follow up on the video from the other day where we talked about our interesting little controller here, computer that not many people have know about or actually much less even seen. So now that you've seen the title of the video, obviously you understand this controller is the computer for the Corvette FX3 Selective Ride Control System. Of course, this would be Section 3G in your service manual if you have it. Now, to give you an overview, basically, an understanding of what this system is, we need to go back a little bit to all the way to the 50s, where active suspension has been kind of one of the, what's the word I'm looking for? The things that, the Moby Dick, if you will, the white whale, for engineers for many years, all the way back into the 50s, where they wanted to be able to control or actually had the suspension control the movement of the car over different road conditions, varying road conditions, so that you provided obviously a more comfortable feel inside the car. So way back in the 1950s, you had Citroën, which tried an active handling suspension system on one of their cars. I don't remember which model exactly it was. And of course, amazingly, the Cadillac, the 57 Cadillac Brougham, had an active handling suspension. Basically, what an active handling suspension is doing is it's taking inputs on all four corners and then adjusting the shocks to the appropriate level so that you get a comfortable ride and adjust to varying road conditions. Now, this is still a system that, as long as they've been actually trying to do this, we're talking mid-50s, so we're talking 60, almost 70 years here, the manufacturers still have not adapted it to a way to where it's available on every car all over the place, because it's still a pretty complex system. In fact, in relation to Corvettes, the active handling suspension was first attempted in 1989 and 90. They tried an active handling system and they built a prototype, a ZR1. In fact, I've seen this prototype. It was at the Corvette Museum for quite a while, and I think it actually got sold at the bankruptcy auction in 2009. It's floating around out there somewhere. In fact, somebody told me that it was at Hemmings auctions just recently. And I believe they built more than one. They may have built 20 or 25. I don't remember how many they built. But they actually designed a Corvette with an active handling suspension system. And of course, realized that not only was the system way too bulky, took up too much space in the engine compartment, that it was expensive. And the truth was, it really couldn't amortize that cost over a lot of the cars. Now, this is kind of the, what do you want to say, the backup or the consolation prize system, okay? Now, this system and this controller, this what this does, is because the RPO code is FX3. It was introduced in 1989, and it's more of what you call a semi-adaptive system, and I'll show you why here in just a second. So, what this system did was gave you three different settings via the switch that I showed in the thumbnail picture in the center of the console there for touring, sport, or performance driving, right? And of course, the computer itself would adapt the firmness of the shocks based on what it felt was the road surface at the time. Now, this was a pretty successful option to put on the Corvettes, considering that when they introduced this, there were only a couple more options that were more expensive than this, right? Namely the convertible hardtop that they introduced in 89, which was around $2,000, a ZR1 package, obviously. But this suspension control, this FX3 suspension control, Selective Ride, was a $1,700 option. I mean, that's expensive, guys, in the realm of options on Corvettes back in the day. And not only was it that expensive, but they managed to sell over 33,000 Corvettes over the 7 years they produced this, 89 to 95, and a lot of people bought this, but a lot of people still really didn't understand what this system did. So, you know, if we go basically to our service manual and our trusty owner's manual, of course, they give this about half a paragraph in this owner's manual. It says you may have a ride control system on your Corvette called real-time damping, which is funny. Oh, you know what? You know why it's got a different name? Because this is a 96, because it actually went to a different name in 96, but I can't. They changed the computer on it in 96 and the actuators, so it actually had more input. So disregard what I'm using here. I should have had a 95 or earlier owner's manual. But anyway, the Selective Ride Control System consists of front and rear adjustable shock absorbers, shock absorber electrical actuators, a Selective Ride Control switch, and a Selective Ride Control module. The SRC system is capable of setting the vehicle suspension at various damping positions by use of the SRC switch and automatically depending on vehicle speed input to the SRC module. That's where the computer makes its own decision, obviously. The SRC shock absorber operates in the same manner as a standard gas shock absorber. The shock absorbers are gas charged to reduce aeration foaming of the shock fluid, results in unlimited damping control. They also reduce impact harshness, improve road isolation, and reduce crash through extreme of jounce and rebound. Electrical actuators position on top of each adjustable shock absorber. So this was basically the compromise position when they realized active suspension was just not going to be feasible at the time. So this can be considered basically, again, we're going back to the granddaddy of some of the MagRide suspension technology that they have on the new Corvettes, which is quite impressive, I must say. But still, even now in 2022 now, is not a truly active suspension. It's just a very adaptive suspension, not so much so semi-adaptive. So the way this system actually worked was you had these basic components. This was it. You had the controller, right? And I think it does show us. Yes. So you had the controller, right? You had the wiring harness that was separate. It ran from this controller to the four different actuators, which would be these right here, and was tied into the fusible link junction block right behind the battery. And then, of course, you had four shocks. So really, you only had this times four, and this one component, and the associated wiring harness, and that was it. That's all this system was comprised on. And essentially, all this system did, right, was would take, you see this interesting little geared knob on top of here? And what it would do is it would turn that knob with that actuator. And what it would do is it would make the orifice tubes. There's actually I'm trying to figure out what I'm trying to say here. The orifice tube runs down this way. And what it would do is it would change the size of the orifice tube, allowing the gas to go through at a larger rate or smaller rate, which would adjust the tension, right, or the travelability of the shocks, right? So that was basically it. And what it did, like I said, was you had three inputs that you could control, right? Touring, sport, or performance. And then, of course, the computer could make changes on its own. Now, what's interesting is they never bothered to say anywhere in the system was there must have been intermediate steps in between those three different control steps, because it does call out for six different positions that this could have actually been through. So I'm going to have to do some deeper digging on that, because I'm not sure what other positions it may have actually had. It may have just been an intermediate step between those three positions. So regardless, this little module here was also capable of running self-diagnostic. Of course, it would light this check engine light, not check engine, but the service ride control light if it was not functioning properly. You could query this system and it would give you actually DTC codes. Okay, so you actually have quite a few DTC codes, 23, 13, 22, 31, 32, all of them that would come up. Now, with all these codes that would come up in this system, what was really funny about this is that the system, the highest failure point on the entire system was either this or this. This so rarely goes out. I very, not often, do not sell these at all. In fact, I probably have 15 of these sitting on my shelf waiting for customers, just because they're made very well. And they're kept, if I can find the picture, they're kept in a really... No, they don't even show it in here. The location of this is tucked in the inner storage compartment right behind the ABS module on the driver's side of the car, tucked in the corner in such a secure spot that you'll never see it. And if you remember where I showed you guys on the ASR system, how they actually closed off the driver's side storage compartment so you couldn't get in there, that's why nobody notices this, because it sits against, tucked against that wall, and you will never notice it. And if you look down in there, you're not even going to see the writing on the outside of this module, the part number. So it's, in fact, a lot of these even get scrapped just because nobody sees them when they dismantle the cars. So basically, this would send the inputs or outputs, commands, to your actuators right here. And this basically would control the movement of the shocks. Now, what I'm going to show you here, if I can get enough light in it, you see those geared teeth inside of there? They're nylon. What does that remind everybody of? It reminds you of the headlight gears inside the C4 and all the other GM headlights. And if you look right there, you can see it's broken. They're always, always hopelessly broken inside of here, broken into pieces. Not only that, what also happens, as with this shock, you can see half of that gear is actually just broken off of it. It looks like a very small little pop metal style gear. Now it'll still turn, right? But what happens is, when this gets the command to turn it, and if it's broken, it's not going to be able to turn it. It's going to give you that check engine light. And these only have about a 90 degree angle of rotation from one setting all the way to the other, to the third position. So there's really not much room for travel. So it's a neat system. Okay, don't want to act like it is not a neat system, but it's basically a high failure item, and it's extremely expensive to fix. Now, this falls right up there with the low tire pressure warning system. They were really cool when they came out, but a lot of guys don't even bother to try to replace them because the sensors are expensive and you've got to find some that work. In this case, I know that Bilstein actually offered a rebuild service on these for a while. I don't know if they currently do. Maybe somebody can tell me if they know in the comments below. But these are expensive to rebuild. I mean, you're talking, you would probably have $3,500 into a system to get a freshly rebuilt system. Maybe not that much, but it wasn't cheap. And I will say that of the four C4s that are in my fleet here at VetteSource, the 90ZR1, the 92 black convertible hardtop 6-speed, and then of course our two LT4s here, the LT4s do not have the FX3 suspension. They wouldn't anyway. They actually would have the F45 suspension at that point, because they went to a more real-time damping. That's where they changed the verbiage. And if I'm remembering correctly, I may be misremembering, but even though they went to a real-time dampening suspension, and it actually has different actuators than this on the 96, it's actually got a flat box, computer box, at each location, each independent location, and then it's got a an actuator rod, a clevis rod, that connects to the shock in a certain way and then turns that back and forth, so it's more sturdy than this. But from what I'm remembering reading about that, they said that in 96, even though the system was on the car, they weren't quite sure about the programming yet on how to get it right, so it didn't have as much functionality as it was supposed to. Now, that just may be an urban legend, but for some reason, I do remember hearing that in the musings and writings of people about this. So, really a neat system, really an expensive system, but the truth is, it's only pretty much good for bragging rights at this point, because the fragile nature of this system would drive you crazy if you were trying to tune it or to make sure it works right. And of course, if you were the type that's going for NCRS correct, let's just put it right now, the more options your C4 Corvette has at your late one, the more money you're going to spend to get that top gold or top flight, I'm sorry, designation on your car. So that's going to wrap it up today with this system. This is one of the last subsystems I wanted to talk about on these C4s. I am probably going to go over the electronic air conditioning here pretty soon in the future, and a few other ideas you guys have given me. I do appreciate the feedback everybody's been giving me, some of the good video ideas, so we'll just keep things up going this year, and I hope everybody's had a great start to their new year so far, and I'll be back next time with some more videos for you. Check you guys out then.